Good morning, siblings in Christ, and welcome to Brownsville United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Greg Reffner, and I am so glad that you are a part of our faith family this morning. Today, we gather as the body of Christ. Although we are spread out in our homes all across the neighborhood, the city, the state, and the country, God has still been gathering us in so that we might hear from God and that we as the body might respond collectively to what God is saying to us and what God is doing in our lives and in our communities. And this Sunday, that looks a little bit differently because today is the celebration of the saints, All Saints Sunday, where we come in solemn prayer to remember those who have gone before us in the past year, but also to remember the eternal promises of God. And so, friends, no matter if you have experienced loss in this year, or maybe not, you are invited to come, to bring all of who you are to God today in worship, through the singing of our songs, through our prayers, and through our responses. As you get logged in and settled, you will find everything that you need to participate well in this service here in the worship video, including the responses to those prayers and the lyrics to our songs. If you'd like, you can also access the worship bulletin there in the comments to your right. You'll also find there a virtual connect card. And whether it's your first, your second, or your 500th time worshiping with us, would you take a moment to fill out that card so that we can know that you are here and so that we might know how we can pray for and with you in the coming days. The last thing that I want to make sure you hear me say here at the beginning of our time together is that Brownsville United Methodist Church is a Christian congregation that seeks to declare and demonstrate God's boundless love for all. And what that means for us, where the rubber hits the road, is that no matter who you are, where your family comes from, or who you love, we pray that you would feel God's welcome here in this space. For truly, again, it is God who gathers us. We are but the messengers of this love and this welcome. So come, siblings, no matter where you are, and let us join our hearts together in the call to worship.
Good morning. Please join me for the call to worship, reading the bolded parts. We have come to affirm our historic faith, to worship the God of our mothers and fathers. We have come to remember God's benefits to us, the living, to respond in thanksgiving to the mighty works of God in our lives. We have come to affirm our trust in the God of all futures, to whose names be blessing and honor, glory and power forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 7, verses 9 through 17. After this I looked, and there was a great crowd that no one could number. They were from every nation, tribe, people, and language. They were standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They wore shining robes and held palm branches in their hands. They cried out with a loud voice, "Victory belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels stood in a circle around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell face down before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and always. Amen." Then one of the elders said to me, "Who are these people wearing shining robes, and where did they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." Then he said to me, "These people have come out of great hardship. They have washed their robes and made them brilliant in the Lamb's blood. This is the reason they are before God's throne. They worship him day and night in his temple, and the one seated on the throne will shelter them. They won't hunger or thirst anymore. No sun or scorching heat will beat down on them, because the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them. He will lead them to the springs of life-giving water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray together. Oh God, here we are before you with eager hearts and eager ears. We pray that in the moments ahead, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts would be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you are our rock, you are our redeemer, you are our friend. In the midst of grief, in the midst of joy, and most importantly, in the midst of hope. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. So you might be asking, do Methodists even believe in the saints? And if you were to ask this, I would say, that's a very good question. And the answer is both yes and no. Let me explain. See, on the one hand, John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, cautioned the earliest followers against holding the saints in too high regard. More specifically, though, he cautioned the people against invoking the saints through prayer. And why would he do this? Well, for one, he says in his writings that there's no scriptural foundation that he can see for such practices. But perhaps the more important historical factor is that the adoration of the saints was a quote-unquote Romish practice or a Catholic practice. And it really wasn't cool to be associated with the Roman Catholic Church in 18th century England, because it could be seen as actually an act of treason against the Church of England, against the church and the state, which were really like one thing. So there's some political dynamics at play, and we shouldn't be surprised, because it seems as though throughout Jesus' ministry and all the way up until today, there's always this bleed over and crossing between religion and politics, right? But John Wesley did not give up on regarding the saints altogether. No, in fact, on All Saints Day, 1756, Wesley wrote in his journal, quote, "How superstitious are they who scruple giving God solemn thanks for the lives and deaths of God's saints." Now, I'm thankful to be married to a Victorian scholar who can help decipher words like scruple for me, scruple being another word for something immoral, proper, wrong. You get the idea. So see, this is a really interesting peering. At the same time, Wesley is saying, you know, we may not want to pray to the saints, but he does say that we should give thanks to God for the witness of their lives and the eternal belonging that has been found in their deaths. And this insistence to remain mindful of those who have gone before us makes sense if you know a little bit about John Wesley's life and family. Take, for example, his mother, Susanna Wesley. She was an incredible person on all accounts. Her husband was an Anglican minister, and when he was away, she would often fill gathering spaces, large crowds, just to hear her devotions, larger crowds than her husband, the ordained preacher. Susanna led prayer meetings, raised up and schooled an entire household of children, and was, in fact, the main spiritual voice, the main force of early spiritual formation for John and his brother Charles. And so I can certainly understand that when Susanna died in 1742, John did not want to give up on the idea that his mother, who had encouraged him so much in his faith, would be unable to continue doing so in her death. Like John, we too have experienced the death of beloved family and friends. Those who encouraged us in the faith and those who offered us faith to borrow when we had none. Today, on the Feast of All Saints, we have the opportunity to remember not only their lives and their witness, but to remember the promises of eternity which we cling to. So what of these promises? In the passage read from Revelation, the evangelist John is catching a glimpse of it. What is it that he sees? The first thing that strikes us should be the size of this gathering. A great multitude that no one could count. It's clear this is not just a gathering of the saints in and around the Brownsville United Methodist community. No, this is what we dream about when we talk about the church as an inclusive community. At this heavenly feast are people of every nation, every tongue, every race, ethnicity, gender, sexuality, socioeconomic status, and ability. Friends, if nothing else, let the image of this inclusive gathering be fixed in your mind today. Although our church, it may not be that God is calling us and every faith community to be multi-ethnic and multilingual, we are reminded that in our lives here on earth, God desires us to have a table fellowship, to learn and be led by a diversity and variety of voices. In this way, we emulate the beauty of this heavenly feast on this side of eternity. Now, the other thing that is interesting about this text is when the elder asks John, who are these people in shining robes? It is as if the people were unknown to the angel, or maybe it was a rhetorical question. At any rate, I prefer John's answer. It's my go-to as well when I'm feeling a little uncertain. He says, well, you tell me. And eventually, we are told, this great diverse crowd are those who have come out of great hardship. They are those who have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb, making them beautifully brilliant. Who are these? These are the ones who have known and been through both the large and small struggles of this life. Who are these? These are the ones who through their baptism put on Christ, put on his life, and lived it as if it were their own. Who are these, you might ask? These are the ones who, like Christ, will be raised to new life and will be clothed in God's glory. Who are these? These are the ones who loved us, who encouraged us, who persisted with us. They are the ones who remain with us in the spirit, although not in the body. They are those who have cheered us on throughout this challenging year and whose words of wisdom and promise still ring in our ears yet today. Who are these? These are the ones whom we have known by name. And so it is good, right, and holy to name each of these saints, to remember their lives and their witness, but to also remember the eternal promises of God that cannot be broken by death. As I read these names, I will chime the singing bowl. Now, if you're not familiar with the singing bowl, it is a traditional Tibetan instrument that has been used for meditation and prayer in a variety of religious and spiritual traditions. In the Christian tradition, and in my experience, it has been used as an instrument to invite the gathered community to a state of contemplation and prayer. For us today, may the chime, after each name read, be a small yet real representation of the song that each of these saints is singing with the whole company of heaven. Amen. Blessing and glory, wisdom and thanksgiving, and honor and power and might be to our God forever and always. Amen. Justo Atkinson. Barbara Bode. Helen Queller. Elizabeth Deck. Shirley Ewell. Peggy Hager. Millie Huey. Stephen Lammers. Mary Lacow. Edie McCauley. Pete Melia. Jean Natkin. Jim Noland. Warren Norman. Barbara Pierce. Jan Post. Joan Tollefson. Sophia Weber. Betty Westfall. Friends, hear the good news that we do not wander through the wilderness alone, that God's Holy Spirit accompanies us, and in addition, the communion of saints sings around us, spurring us on, encouraging us on towards that vision, towards the reality of that heavenly feast. A table where there is not hunger, where there is not thirst, where scorching heat and death are no more. And all God's people on earth and in heaven said together in one voice, Amen.
My life flows on in endless song, above earth's lamentation. I hear the real, though far off, hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? Above the tumult and the strife, I hear the music ringing. It sounds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? What through the tempest loudly roars, I hear the truth in liveth. What through the darkness round me close, songs in the night it giveth. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? When tyrants tremble, sick with fear, and hear their death knell ringing, when friends rejoice both far and near, how can I keep from singing? In prison cell and dungeon vile, our thoughts to them are winging. When friends by shame are undefiled, how can I keep from singing? My life flows on in endless song, above earth's lamentation. I hear the real, though far off, hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth,
As we continue in worship, I want to ask you a question. And this is a question that we will keep coming back to for the next 3 weeks. And it's a question about where we expect to encounter God in worship. You know, when I was in seminary and I had a professor ask my class this, we got a lot of the same response. In the preached word, in the public reading of scripture, maybe it's in the communion table or our singing. Those were some of the most popular answers. Interestingly, not one person, myself included, said that they most expect to encounter God when we give of our finances, when we offer back all of who we are, including our physical resources, back to God. And this is a really interesting idea for me. It's a question that I want us to continue to wrestle with throughout the rest of the month of November. What is our relationship with money? And what do we expect? What do we want God to do with that? You know, I believe that each time we drop a dollar or two in the offering plate, or we send in a physical contribution to the church, that is not only a gift to the church, which it is, but it is an explicit ask to God to take this gift and use it to transform our relationship with money. Wesley uses the language going on to Christian perfection or being perfected in love. And this is one area of discipleship which I will admit I often overlook. So anyway, that's the teaser for our upcoming stewardship series. I wanted to ask you, though, this morning. Do you expect to encounter God at this time in the worship service? We have heard the word of God proclaimed. We are responding now to God's word. God is wanting to do something in us. And so whether you feel called to give $1 or $100, I invite you now to discern, to ask yourself, to ask God, what an act of generosity might look like for you today. If you do feel called to give to the ministry and mission of Brownsville United Methodist Church, there are a few key ways that you can do that. You can, as always, mail in a physical contribution to our church, to our physical church building. You can use the address on your screen to set up an automatic bill pay through your financial institution, or you can log in to our secure online partner, Tithely, and set up and manage both one-time and recurring contributions. Again, the amount is not what is important, but it is a move in discipleship, an ask for God to come and transform the way that we view and handle and steward our finances. So come, siblings in Christ, let us offer our gifts with joy and thanksgiving to God. Would you pray with me? God of all generations, as we worship today, we offer our whole selves to you, and that we have and all that we are. Like your saints who have gone before us, we pray that you will help us be bold in our mission and in our witness. May we who have been given so much give freely, ministering in your compassion to the multitudes near to us and far from us, so that one day we may stand amidst the multitude that gathers at your heavenly throne. We pray this in the name of our Savior and Redeemer, Christ our Lord. Amen. As we continue in prayer, you are invited to join me as we pray, not my prayers, but the prayers of the people. We are a church that prays for and with one another, and on Sunday morning, what that looks like is the use of a prayer response. So if this is your first time or you're not familiar with this, no worries. The words will be on your screen. And as I pray, you will occasionally hear me say the words, "Lord, in your mercy," and you are invited to respond with the congregation the words, "Hear our prayer." So, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and who now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we have named aloud and for those that we hold in our hearts. For the many who have died at the hands of the COVID-19 pandemic and at the hands of racism and systems of oppression. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them. And help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us throughout our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with human hands, but eternal in the heavens, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, even though there is so much to grieve, we are committed to being a people who give thanks to you for daily and unexpected blessings. We give thanks for a technology that connects us across space and allows us to be in fellowship with one another. We give thanks for rich traditions that intersect with ours that invite us into spaces of contemplation and prayer. As we continue to navigate the waters of grief and pain, help us to grow in our thankfulness, to see you in the mundane, and to recognize your grace that abounds all around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear our prayers, O God, for those who are hurting in pain or in need of healing. For Nick, Brigetta, Renee, and Terry. For those who are living in the Gulf Coast and who are reeling from yet another hurricane, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Dorothy, a dear friend, as she transitions into hospice care in the final stages of her life, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world, O God. It seems as though this past week has been among the worst during this pandemic. We confess that we are prone to growing weary and tired from living cautiously. Help us, we pray, to continually seek to do good and to love our neighbors well by practicing every precaution necessary until the day when this virus ceases to exist. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for this country. We pray for those who look at recent actions of Congress and wonder if they are about to experience the stripping away of their rights. We pray especially for the LGBTQ community and mothers who need access to quality reproductive care. We pray for the upcoming election. We name before you and one another our anxieties and fears about what will happen. Grant us all patience to see the process through, to ensure that every voice is heard and that the results are received as graciously as possible. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For your church throughout the world, we pray. And for this community, Brownsville United Methodist Church, we pray. Fill us with love, hope, and faith so that we might bear faithful witness to Jesus with our words and our actions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, you created each of your children in your image. And so as we move with the saints towards that heavenly feast, grant to us the grace and the power to fearlessly contend against evil and injustice in whatever form it may take, to make no peace with oppression, no peace with racism, homophobia, xenophobia, no peace with fear of each other. Where there is hatred, let us bring love. Where there is injury, may we bring your healing. Until that day when we might embrace each other and the world as you see us. A world where every nation, tongue, and people are deemed of sacred worth. No human declared illegal. And where all are beloved by their neighbors as they are beloved by you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For those who have been forgotten, for those who we have promised to remember in prayer, and for those who have no one to remember them, we lift them up to you now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. I invite you now to offer your own prayers and petitions, either silently or aloud, as the Holy Spirit leads. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now, let us join with one voice the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, knowing that God's love goes beyond that of father and mother. We pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Sweet Jesus Christ, my sanity. Sweet Jesus Christ, my clarity. Bread of heaven broken for me. Cup of salvation held up to drink. Jesus, mystery. Christ has died and Christ is risen, and Christ will come again.
Friends of God, as we prepare to go out into the world, I want to give my deep thanks to both Noli and Priscilla for helping to lead worship this morning. I also want to make sure if you have not yet heard or not yet received the invitation to join us at our Zoom coffee hour happening here in just a few moments at 11 a.m. Pacific time on Zoom. And if you haven't joined us yet, today is a great day to pop in. We will be celebrating Holy Communion. And so I invite you to come prepared with some kind of bread, some kind of grape juice, fermented or not. those elements are preferable, but of course, any solid or liquid that you have available will do the trick. I really look forward to seeing you all there and to celebrating the sacrament with you. Would you receive now this benediction? Friends, as you go out, as you go to join your song with the whole company of heaven, may the peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, keep you in the knowledge and grace of God. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you always. Amen. Friends, go in peace to serve the Lord. Amen.